I was instructed to hold your attention if possible while he arrives, so I'll try and entertain you in the meanwhile. All the serious stuff will happen once he arrives. And the attempt, perhaps, maybe what I can do in the meanwhile is try and say where I'll try and lead him into. It's a tough ask for me because I've been, in some sense, like a lot of us in our mid-40s and younger people who grew up reading him and learning about ecology and the works he did, taught us and at least gave us direction at certain stage. So I decided in the morning it was going to be very tough to talk to him and not keep smiling like a fanboy. So I will do the job of a devil's advocate before him instead. And I primed myself in almost theatrical performance of the questions I can ask that might hopefully disturb him a little and get better answers than a fan can get. Couple of things that Madhav's done which are fascinating in different ways. Kerala perhaps knows him for his work on Western Ghats, which is more recent vintage in some sense. Kerala would perhaps remember him as a person who was at least initially faced a little brunt for what he had said and suggested and recommended in his Western Ghats report when he said a certain area should be cordoned off. The kind of work that was allowed, the kind of development that was allowed in certain areas in Kerala, in substantial parts of Kerala, should alter, should be contained, should be regulated, and should move in a direction that is seen at least by his team of ecologists as ecologically more secure in the short and the long run. In practical terms, it did mean that a lot of things that were happening in the name of development, Kerala would get suspended or would need to completely transform and move away. Say, from plantations, you would need to move back to multi-cropping systems that existed, say, 300, 400, sometimes 500 years ago. He suggested in his report, along with other ecologists, a series of changes, a series of disincentives that must be given to citizens to move away from what he believed was ecologically disastrous for Kerala and other areas in Western Ghats. He gave a series of recommendations saying what should the government push, incentivize, and convince the citizens to do to earn a livelihood in coming years. I remember at the time when he wrote this, and I was working with the Hindu at that time, that he faced a barrage of criticism for having stepped in out of the blue and told six states what to do with almost a third of their land and I think about a fourth of their people. And this was a valid question. I'm actually playing a trick on you if you realize I'm trying to get you on my side before he arrives and I'm going to do the same questions to him. What was fascinating was to me that he recommended a setup of governing Western Ghats in a way that rest of these six states were not governed by. So rest of the six states would continue to be governed by politicians, elected representatives. They would continue to do what they did. But in the Western Ghats area in Kerala and elsewhere, all the way running up till Gujarat, he recommended that because Western Ghats was a special area in some sense, it did have biodiversity of the form that exists in rare spaces in India, and one can argue about that, that therefore Western Ghats needed to be protected in some sense that I see from politics as usual. It needed to be protected from the political economy that exists in India. Therefore, a completely new governance system was required for this place is what the Western Ghats report recommended. He had one tier that was very often talked about after and before the floods in Kerala, where he recommended that the decisions on these important economic issues should be left to the Gram Sabhas and the Gram Panchayats. It should not be taken by politicians and elected representatives only at the capitals of these states or in Delhi, but should be left to the individual community level, the lowest possible denominator or highest possible denominator of a community, which is in general terms the Gram Sabha, is what should take a call on whether we should have a certain road in an area, should we build a certain kind of factory in a village or not, should we have this dam or not, should all be left to communities. this obviously drew from his work that he had done earlier on biodiversity registers, which was also asking villages to register what kind of biodiversity they had in order to protect it, hopefully, in the longer run. There was a second tier, and I do see Madhav coming in. I'm not going to leak out the dirty questions I'm going to ask him, so I'll let him come in, and then maybe I'll pick it up. So we're going to focus on the Western Ghats report, but while the organizers have asked us to stick to that and look at how the Madhav's recommendations impacted Kerala, we'll probably go a bit further than that to look at ecology as a subject itself. Madhav.
Here's Madhav Gadgil joining our session. We welcome Madhav Gadgil to KLF 2020.
Thank you. I used the opportunity while you were not here. So he was just saying he's a bit exhausted and he needs 5 more minutes to relax and ease off before he can converse.
I had a very interesting experience of an urban guerrilla driver honking and speeding beyond all reasonable limits for last half an hour. So I need to quietly sit for a few minutes if you will pardon me. Thank you.
Would you want a cup of coffee or something in the meanwhile? Okay. So I'll continue yapping while he takes a break, and then we'll come back to real conversations. Some of the work that Madhav's headed is, which is now remembered less because it's become so much part of Indian history, is the setting up of the Indian Institute of Science, creating a department there which looked at ecology more deeply than it had been done at any other place. Before that, we had work which was either done purely on conservation in some sense of save the tiger, save this animal, save this plot of land, but did not look at how human societies interact with nature in more complex ways than conservation would generally tell us. Some of the more fascinating work as IIC grew up was looking at this at scales across geographies from northeast down into the Western Ghats, in areas that people had gone before but not seen things that his students and the hundreds of them by now who were seeing across the country. The second part, which to my mind was actually much more fascinating and was building up a credible knowledge base that we didn't have, was to look at, in some ways, the politics of managing ecology in India. This was never an upfront subject in the work they did as scientists, but it was underlying a lot of research that came out and the direction and the questions they asked in their research. Dozens of his students across generation, I think now 3 generations roughly, I would think, have produced immense volume, which has become the base for a lot of us to work upon, write upon in other universities. Something like CS has not been replicated in India even today. It's the only center of that kind that exists in any Indian university or any Indian institution, even after 50 years, 60 years of him starting off to do that. Well, he's given me the signal to stop yapping and ask him questions instead, and I'll try and do that. Madhav, before you came, I was obviously referring back to your Western Ghats report, and I remember that you first published it. It didn't have a great reception in Kerala, at least from a certain segment, but it was very vocal. Post-floods, that changed. If I can say that on behalf of citizens of Kerala, you almost became a hero in some sense for them, for having said and warned Kerala about what would happen. At the time when you first felt a backlash from a certain segment, if not a large segment of society in Kerala and elsewhere, what were your first thoughts at that time? When you'd done the report and you see this, there was a pushback from the state governments as well as from certain segments of powerful segments of society.
Well, thanks for those questions. Let me recount the history of this Western Ghat Ecology Expert Panel report. It was submitted in September 2011. So promptly, the Ministry of Environment and Forests, which had changed hands by then, because earlier Jairam Ramesh was the minister, and the entire report, in fact, was placed before Jairam Ramesh and all the senior officials of the ministry in, I guess, July. And they had all okayed it and made some few suggestions. We had taken them on board and submitted it in September. So there was no question really that it contained anything which should have been objected to. But by that time, things had changed. And the government promptly decided that it was a report that needed to be suppressed because it will hurt the country's development aspirations. So it was suppressed. And of course, luckily now we have a good tool for democracy, which is the Right to Information Act. So from Kerala itself, some people applied under the RTI, and in 2012 May. Firstly, in April, the Central Information Commissioner made very strong remarks against this suppression and said it must be immediately opened up. Then into 1 month's time, the ministry had gone to Delhi High Court, which made even stronger remarks against the ministry. So in May 2012, it had to be made available. Now, I had expected all these reactions because it was an entirely honest report. And obviously, there were not only in Kerala, but throughout the country and in other states, very strong vested interests which would not be able to make the kind of illegitimate gains that they were making by destroying nature and suppressing democratic processes. But this had been going on, and I was fully aware. So I never expected that the governments would accept the report as it was. They would bring up all sorts of things. I did not quite imagine the levels to which they will go. The Maharashtra government, for example, on its own website, published a so-called Marathi summary of the report, which was actually very mischievous distortion of the report. Publicly, the government did this. Now, I did not expect them to go to this length, maybe to say many things and say they don't accept, but not quite this kind of mischievous distortion, but that was also done. Then the Chief Minister of Maharashtra is a very highly educated person, a graduate of IIT Mumbai, gave a talk in the Mumbai IIT to the faculty and students saying that, please, you must come to my rescue. How do I raise objections to this report? Because nobody has shown me anything which is factually wrong, and apparently there is nothing against any of our constitutional provisions or existing laws, but I have to oppose it. So please tell me. So some of my friends who were at this talk told them, told me about all this, and of course they were unable to come up with anything. So this was going on. In Kerala, worse things were going on. So I was not at all surprised. I was actually quite pleasantly surprised that, I don't know how large a section, but quite a few people in Kerala, because in Kerala, the Kerala Shastra Sahitya Parishad promptly prepared and made available a Malayalam summary, actually had access to what was in the report, and they were very supportive of me. So a lot of people are saying, oh, you were drummed out of Kerala. I don't know. I was being welcomed with open arms in Kerala by a large number of friends. I don't know who else. Of course, there was a big lobby against it. So my impression might very well have been that I was being drummed out of Kerala. I never felt so. So all these forces will play their roles, and of course the government will, all governments, state governments, all state governments and central government would try to resist it. But there were other unexpected developments. In Kerala itself, the Aranmula airport controversy actually led to the local BJP group supporting the report. And there were demonstrations in favor of acceptance of the report. And in Koikot district only, in some place, a boy called Anoop, who was part of a peaceful demonstration to accept the recommendations, they were also demonstrating against the illegal rock quarrying. And apparently, gundas from the quarry lobby were pelting stones and country bombs, and he died also. And he was Hindu Aikyavedi or maybe some such political formation man. So there was also this kind of political support. There were some CPI MLAs also, and MP one, and some Muslim League also, MLAs who met me, and they said they are very much in favor. Congress also had some green, ginger group. So throughout, after 2012, there were many such people supporting all along. After 2015 elections, the BJP made a 180% turn. I don't know exactly why, whatever it was. And suddenly, very interestingly, many people who were good friends, I had many such interesting experiences. Bureaucrats who were earlier under Jairam Ramesh were very warm to me, suddenly discovered that they did not know this person, who this person was. So the same happened with, I'm afraid, BJP people. Suddenly they discovered that they don't know who this chap is. Earlier they were talking to me with great warmth. Anyway, so such things happened. But then I was personally confident that our report had very sound scientific basis. So a lot of things which we said would be undesirable consequences which are bound to happen are beginning to happen. In 2018 floods and these landslides, 19 are part of what, Madhav, as a scientist, I expected Dr. would
Gadgil,
happen.
Dr. Gadgil.
And so there is this.
Can
reaction.
I interject? I'm so sorry. I have to also, I've been given the clock that I have to make sure we have enough questions spread through this. Sorry, so I'll do this really bad job of being an insolent boy who'll keep saying, wait, I have another question. One part of your report, to me as a journalist who was looking at it, was fascinating. At one level, you brought back the idea that good ecological governance requires Gram Sabha, village level decision making. At the same time in that report, there was the idea of setting up a Western Ghats authority. Largely that authority would be populated by ecologists like you, I remember, and there would be representatives from elected representatives and others also involved. One of the arguments that a lot of people raised, and I found some credence in that, was that report in some sense had a dual executive note. It once said, let villages take decisions, but if these decisions were egregious and large projects were being coming, that report suggested that the elected representatives be short-circuited and the decision on what gets done in this area be taken by a Western Ghats committee, which is not answerable to the people because it's not an elected community. It's a bunch and selection of ecologists sitting on top taking decisions of economic nature as well as ecological nature across six states. To some people's mind, that was questioning the kind of electoral democracy that we would have, and at the cost of saving environment, would it be valid to then say at some points you can short circuit democracy, even if it's working bad or good, and set up something that becomes like a special committee of experts? In most places, these kind of committees, and we have committees of Supreme Court which has done this kind of role, they've not come out doing very well. Experts which are get nominated by government, as say Jairam might have nominated you, the next minister may have nominated somebody else. But nominated committees of experts, mostly in democracies, fail to deliver on very diverse set of decisions that need to be required to do development work. Do you think, if you look back now, that idea of setting up a Western Ghats committee where ecologists can decide the entire economic framework for six states, or at least a region of the six states, is something that a democracy can afford?
See, I was bound to go by the mandate given by the government when they set up the panel. Now, if you will read the terms of the mandate, then there was one, which is of course not on public record, there was part of that mandate was that the panel should consult elected representatives and officials of various relevant departments of the state governments before finalizing their report. I requested, and Jairam Ramesh agreed, that that should be modified so that it would include widespread consultations at the grassroots level with the people also, which he agreed to. So that
I was referring to the final recommendation in your report.
I am coming
which
to
sets
that.
Up a committee. We can focus on that.
Fine, I agree. Now, then the mandate itself said that there will be such a Western Ghats Ecology Authority professional and so on. That was not my idea. If I had the freedom to change that part of the mandate also, actually, I would have done so. But it is not possible. I discussed also, not in writing, at personal level. And it was felt, Jairam Ramesh also thought, he was the person who had really genuine concern and was thinking that let there be such a authority. So I was.
Did you personally think it's a dangerous idea to have only a selected bunch of ecologists running governance?
It is a dangerous idea if the experts are not accountable and are not obliged to take feedback from the ground upwards. So I have actually the body of the report, if you will read, in many places clearly said that experts should not be making all decisions at all, that the environmentally positive decisions very much depend on the experience, first-hand experience of local communities, and therefore it is not proper for experts to abrogate this kind of a role and take on their own. And that the panel, the authority should be open. We had also, if you look into detail, said that there should be decentralized further system of providing inputs to the authority and so on, going right down to the district levels and trying to get inputs from the people. This is part of our report. Now, nobody really carefully reads, but the whole...
I read your report over about 3 weeks.
I was certainly not in favor. In fact, I have long experience of the so-called experts who especially depend only on bureaucrats, what kind of inputs they get, and what kind of very improper recommendations they make. Just to take 2 minutes. So I was part of the Goa government's Golden Jubilee Development Council. We had the first meeting at which the bureaucrats told wholeheartedly that all of Goa's farmers are utterly lazy and they are very happy with this money compensation that the mines give, and they want mining to go on without questioning it at all. I said, I have seen in the field and I don't believe this. And I forced the Golden Jubilee Development Council to agree to for me to go to villagers, get their inputs. For 6 nights, I stayed in 6 different villages, slept on the floor with the villagers, brought back those inputs and forced the panel to modify the report, which would otherwise have said, mining is utterly wonderful for Goa. So I have those experiences, and I was certainly not in favor. This, the interpretation which has been put is completely uncalled for, and in part it happened because this was part of the mandate handed over to us.
So, sorry if I'll sound really insolent saying this, but the parallel you draw of you as a benevolent expert, and I do believe that you are somebody who was trying to save environment in a fashion that very few were able to do. But if I was to say, I believe I'm an honest person, I want to save environment, and I go and meet out enough people, and I don't talk only to bureaucrats, but I talk to citizenry. But then the decision making lies with me as an expert. As a parallel, if I draw politically, this is exactly what the RSS also says. We are in touch with people, we come back and we bring the voice, we cut short the bureaucracy, we tell the government in power what should be done with society. And you can end up with a government of this nature which then takes undemocratic decisions because it believes it has a mandate from the people, and it's short-circuited democratic processes. Again, I'll try and go back to this question, which I think you did not answer completely, that there was an executive committee to be set up, the Western Ghats Authority, which would have the final say, overriding chief ministers, ministers, elected representatives, which would take a call on whether, say, a hydro dam project can be built in an area or not, a large project can come up in an ecologically sensitive area or not. That decision of the Western Ghats report committee, as cited in the report, would be final and binding on the environment minister. The environment minister, Jairam Ramesh, I must also recollect, while he had done such fantastic work by hiring people like you, in his tenure was the largest number of projects set up that destroyed forests. The largest number of projects that got clearance was in his tenure and not actually in BJP. 99% of the projects in Jairam's tenure got clearance all over the country, including in Western Ghats, even while he was setting up your committee. Now, would it make sense then that you should have not been part of a committee that wanted to set up an undemocratic Western Ghats authority that you did not agree with principally?
No, I believe that I had to accept certain compromises. Throughout the report, if you read, including in the discussion on the Western Ghats Authority, there is continuous emphasis that that authority should not be doing what you are saying it would be doing, which is it would be some supreme authority which would, without setting aside what people wanted, impudently would make these decisions and hand them to chief ministers and all that. That kind of interpretation may have been made, but if you read the entire report, including the sections on this authority, that is not at all what was said. And of course, I had to accept that is the mandate given by the center, and we are submitting a report which is as per the mandate. Then of course we had to say there would be such an authority. But beyond that, every attempt was made to ensure that that authority will not be a dictatorial authority.
One thing that your report did, and you spoke of very often once the report was done, was warning citizens and everyone about the calamities that would befall us if we do not choose a different path. unfortunately for Kerala, some of your warnings came true repeatedly. A question that a lot of people who work on climate change, particularly a theory that they put forth, is there are a lot of damage that comes from variation in environment and climate change right now. The kind of uncertainty it causes in the system, the kind of extremes we are seeing now. Regardless of whether you have higher levels of development or not, you will see these fluctuations damage lives in ways that we've never seen before, at least in the last 600, 700 years. The question that somebody put to me was, and I'm passing it on to you, somebody actually said, if you're going there asking, please ask this question on my behalf, was to say that the challenge in Kerala was its unique geography, the fact that it had much higher levels of development, therefore much higher construction than, say, I come from Manipur and Arunachal, where when we've had earthquakes, we don't have property damage because we don't have properties. We don't have constructed areas. So the damage you were facing in Kerala was because of the kind of high construction we'd seen. There was levels of development in Kerala, some ways is far ahead of rest of India and much more progressive in having gone ahead. But the same development also and the same resources also allowed Kerala to revive itself after these constant floods. Say in Manipur, I know if we have a flood, for next 6 months our livelihoods are destroyed. There is no resource, there is no economy to help build it. The state does not have capacity. Is there a dichotomy where you need growth? At the same time, without this growth, you will also not have the resilience to safeguard yourselves against the challenge of climate change.
No. I think there are, the claim is not that there is no climate change which has not affected. Firstly, the climate change is certainly now, there is plenty of scientific evidence, largely driven by human interventions. And it is not as if, although we would like to pretend and say that it is Americans who are driving this, we are doing nothing, we are also contributing substantially. In particular, there is one aspect of climate change where India is worse than any other country in the world, which is the aerosol particles in the atmosphere. These are small particles which come from dust and enormous quantities from production of so-called M sand, powdering rocks to create artificial man-made sand. And of course, automobile exhausts and many such. India has higher levels of aerosols throughout the country than any other country in the world.
Madhav, sorry, if I may interject and be very insolent right now, I think you've been scientifically wrong. It's a subject I have studied for 10 years. Aerosols contribute around 3% of the global warming compared to carbon dioxide. India contributes even to the aerosols only 15% of the global aerosol volumes in the atmosphere, which last only about average 20 days to 3 months. I don't know if you're scientifically going off here.
No, I am not. I have colleagues, I'm wearing actually their t-shirt, who have the world's leading experts on this. I'm saying the standing levels of aerosol today over India are higher than any other part of the world. And that is empirically well documented. Now, those aerosol particles, I don't have time, let us not go into the technical details, are responsible for changing the pattern of rainfall so that instead of gentle drizzle over several hours, it now becomes intense lashing over a restricted period of time. And because of this, the kind of damage that can be done, say landslides, for example, triggering, and floods also, if you have gentle rain for a long time, you have different kinds of possibilities of floods than if you have this intense lashing of rainfall. And I am basing all this on very good scientific material. What you are quoting is irrelevant here. The fact
is, the UN IPCC report, Madhav, it cannot be irrelevant. It's the UN IPCC report that says aerosol volumes in India are 3% of the global volume, or 4%. Aerosols in India, particularly in the northern belt, impact monsoon on a temporal basis. Global warming, carbon dioxide, which lasts in the atmosphere for more than hundreds of years, is the main reason for global warming. Like local weather changes is what aerosol impacts.
Baba, I'm not talking only of global warming in terms of that particular aspect. Global warming, you may not talk about necessarily as warming only. There are many different aspects to global climate change. What I'm talking about, the intensity of rainfall and its damaging possibilities of damage to land and so on, that is, India has a highest level, standing level. Globally on Earth, of course, India doesn't have, India has, I think, 2.3% of the land area. So these global figures, it is contributing 3% means it's more than contributing its share. But that is not the issue. The standing levels of aerosols in India, I do not know what IPCC exactly says, but they talk about the Asian brown cloud, especially the Indian brown cloud. It is standing, sitting over India. And you can go, this is not the place, but I challenge anybody, because I have very good authority, Dr. Satish, he is himself from Kerala, is one of the world's leading experts on aerosols. He has done these studies, the data very much is there that India as a landmass has at any time around the year higher levels of aerosols. And they may not contribute to global warming. That is not the claim. They are contributing to this intensification of rainfall and possible damages such as landslides. And what has caught people's attention and naturally concerned is landslides like I saw a few months ago at Puthumala in Wayanad, where some out of 60 houses, every one of them was under this deep layer of mud. Large number of people died despite the possible warnings. That is what caught people's attention, and it is an aspect of climate change. It is not just global warming.
Right.
So this is a very important scientific evidence. Secondly, the improper management of the water resources of the state has been responsible for these kinds of levels of flooding and damage. And the River Research Center has done monitoring of Chalkudi River, actually it should be done in every river, our report says, and shown that had the water management in the reservoirs been appropriate, the level of flooding in this Chalkudi River would have been less by at least 1.5 meters, which means, or probably 2 meters, which means that substantial damage would have been averted. This is a consequence of human interventions and improper, unreasonable. You don't need for growth all this. The buildings which are being today or have been demolished in Kochi, they are part of what has contributed to our GDP growth. That is not the kind of growth that is actually favorable to anybody in any way. Destroying mangroves and setting up illegally tall buildings there, so you spend a lot of energy and then you spend another lot of energy demolishing them. This wasteful energy use is what is contributing to global warming. It is all right to calculate percentages, but it is the kind of indisciplined, unnecessary use of energy that goes on in India, which is, I am afraid, maybe US under Trump may match it, but by and large, not matched by other countries in the world.
So again, we went away from the original question I asked about whether growth is important for us to survive climate change. But the other part that you were referring to, again, I'll factually counter it. India's energy consumption per capita, even in the top 1% tier, is 1/20th of an average American. So we are far away in terms of energy consumption. There we are reaching there slowly, unfortunately, as you rightly point out. My second question on along the same points, and if we'll come back to that, is most world over there's now evidence that IPCC and others provide saying one of the best forms of adaptation to climate change, the ability to bring resilience to societies to survive the problems that will arise out of climate change, is to provide sustainable growth. But growth, yes. And in India's case and in Africa's case and other developing countries, IPCC prescribes that a higher per capita consumption of energy, a higher per capita consumption of oil, a higher growth rate at the current stages is essential for even societies to adapt and be resilient. Only the rich amongst us will survive climate change. The poor actually need to grow faster than they have in the past four decades. How do you reconcile that against when we look at individual local environment being protected? If you do not develop around riverlands, if you do not develop along your coastline, this is where most civilizations have developed across the world. Your coastlines is where most European societies have developed. If we don't do the same, and no other country has done any different, why do you think India could do it any different than any other country?
No other country has done any different is not true. You go to many parts of Europe, especially Scandinavia, Norway has the world's highest per capita income. Norway has the world's strongest democracy. Democratic decisions are being taken, and there is the strongest environmental protection laws and implementation of any country in the world. Let me take Sweden is very similar. Let me take just one example. You are talking about growth without looking at what is happening. Sustainable is a word which is used very loosely. Sweden has just pulled out of joint collaboration with pharmaceutical companies in Andhra Pradesh, because those pharmaceutical companies were polluting the waters of Andhra, resulting in production of what they call superbugs. So that there are very serious health issues, because you now have microbes which resist all antibiotics. The consultant whom Sweden engaged told them that in India there is no hope of any implementation of pollution control laws, no hope that these pharmaceutical companies with whom you have collaborations will actually take social responsibility and ensure that there is no discharge of pollutants, and therefore your only option is you pull out. You might also recall that what happened with Bhopal gas disaster in 1992, 8 years I guess, whatever, after the disaster, a vice president of World Bank wrote the famous toxic memo, which said that all polluting industries should go to India, because the value of human life in India is so low that you can pollute there with impunity. So it makes very good sense on basis of all economic theory to send all polluting industries to India. This is continuing. I have friends in German Green Party who tell me that Green Party asked the German industry. Germany is again a very well developed and very strong economy. That in Germany you are accepting all pollution control, and in India you are investing in companies where you allow them to pollute without any limits. He said the German industrialists tell them, we are not fools. In Germany we accept maybe 40% returns on investment. In India, these companies give us 400% returns on investment, because nothing needs to be spent on pollution control. You can suppress people's dissent against pollution with impunity. So we make 400% there. Why should we not make? If India wants that kind of growth, where environments will be destroyed in the long run, the costs will be borne by whom? The health costs which are climbing up are borne by whom? It is part of this kind of allowing. It's not just a matter of unsustainable. It is a matter of destructive, democratically unacceptable growth. And that is what is the question at issue. If you have genuine implementation of all our environment protection laws and the principles of democratic devolution, then you might move towards growth like Norway and Sweden and Germany, not otherwise.
Madhav, again, Norway is rich and it is able to do what it does because it is one of the biggest exporters of oil to the rest of the world. It makes revenue of selling oil to the rest of the world. Therefore, it is able to provide a different kind of safety network. It is also one of the biggest destroyers of forests all over the world. It's one of the biggest timber merchants in the world today. So I don't think Norway is a good example to give of where we should go. But going away from that, and again, it actually reasserted the fact that no country so far, unfortunately, has been able to grow any differently than the standard patterns of growth. The challenge for India, therefore, is how do we increase our ability to be resilient against climate change? How do we have growth where all our children get education, health, not just a small class of people, grow, and that needs energy consumption? At the same time, do it better than anyone else has and not go down the same path. Would you agree that growth is still required for the next 20, 30 years, that every household get the same levels of electricity that you and I get. Get the same levels of health and education.
What levels of electricity? The same lecture was given to me in Mumbai Mantralaya by one of the IAS officers. I said, have you ever been to the countryside? In Ambezogai, we have this big coal burning.
I live in Arunachal, so I live in the countryside.
Okay, you may live, not in the Maharashtra countryside anyway. So in Ambezogai, you have this power plant which is producing large quantities of electricity. All of those are going to Mumbai. I do not know what these figures of IPCC are, but I understand that one of India's richest family spends, I don't know, 10 lakh rupees a month on just electricity bill and all that kind of thing. And do you think, he said, we want to electrify the villages, that's why we need this. I asked, do you know what kind of electrification of villages around Ambezogai has taken place? There is a very good ashramashala there where I lived with the students because they also have a very, very interesting nature education program for 4 days. And that school was getting power. This was the time when the students had to study for exam exactly for 6 hours between 11 o'clock and 5 o'clock at night, and the rest of the day there was no power. Where is the Ambezogai power going to? Is it going to villages for electrification? Then why is this kind of disparity between the power supply to Mumbai and to Ambezogai villages? All over, this is the kind of disparity that is there. And you cannot talk about actually growth which is so-called sustainable, which is allowed to take place where these kind of disparities are continually growing. The government statistics about poverty alleviation and all is very dubious. I have a friend, a senior IAS officer, Naresh Saxena, who has written a paper after careful study of the National Health Survey statistics and the government statistics on nutritional level of school children. The nutritional level of school children have remained at the same level. Even today, after all these years of very rapid growth. 41-42% of school children are malnourished as per the more authentic National Health Survey. This government, state governments produce completely bogus statistics, giving all sorts of other figures. So it is not true that this growth, which we certainly have had, has actually percolated. It is a suck-up process of growth, not percolating down to the grassroots process of growth. Right. And that is the problem which can only be corrected through democratic processes. And of course, the local communities would want proper kind of growth. We have given an example in our report when the Sindhudurg area, some villagers said, we want protection. Then I requested them, please come up with your prescriptions for development and for conservation. And they have talked about what kind of development also they want. And that is the kind which will be, if democratically driven, in the end, sustainable.
Right. Madhav, one last question before we open it up to the audience. We have about 10 minutes. So one last question and then I'll open up. This is actually the only bit, and I've followed your work for 10 years now, like a fanboy, that I showed every paper that used to get out, used to catch up, and I used to call up friends in ISC to read it. There was one paper which disturbed me. This was a paper you wrote along with KC Malhotra, where you explained that caste system actually had an ecological basis and it was good at certain point. From my belief, and I come now from a society where there's no caste at all. I come from Arunachal now and Manipur. Anything that justifies caste and the existence of caste to me is an abhorrent idea. I believe it is Brahminical in the fashion that it controls resources, takes away resources. The argument efficiency, which I read into your paper, is the argument of efficiency that fascist forces have used, that slavery has been justified on. When you look back at that paper, do you still agree with that, what you wrote in that paper? And if you could explain that paper to the audience.
No. I was puzzled, as was my good friend Malhotra, who is country's leading anthropologist, by the fact that globally also, and of course in India, there are societies, tribal societies, which are different, not just in Arunachal, but our Gondwanala and in central India also, where I worked, where caste system did not exist. And there is repeated references in anthropological literature in the world. Why was it that caste system seems to have persisted in India? So it was a historical question. I have been very much interested in historical roots of what has happened. And during our fieldwork, we found that historically, the kind of partitioning of resource use which was going on in the society might have provided certain, so to say, support in the end towards that maintenance of that caste system. So that paper is asking only a historical understanding.
But historically, don't you think it was the fact that a certain segment of society could control resources at the cost of a large majority of citizens, which is exactly what fascism does, exactly what slavery does,
justifies it by
efficiency?
I agree. We never said, therefore, that this is something which just, you know, was the complete picture of what was going on in the society. It was certainly a certain kind of picture which had never been painted before. So as intellectuals, we are very interested in this phenomenon. You can read in the same paper, we say that especially coming of the British, earlier also that there were these other questions, disparities, and that we have never denied. But especially with coming of the British and complete destruction of the natural resource base and taking away local control from the over natural resources, from that time onwards, this system has become completely counter productive or whatever. It should be, there is a lecture I have given on behalf of Indian Council of Social Science Research on whatever social ecological organization of Indian society, where this is repeatedly emphasized that in today's world, this has become a very abhorrent system. Earlier, historically, maybe few centuries ago, there may have been certain useful consequences of that in a limited fashion. That's all.
Madhav, I'll open this to the audience with just one last sentence. To my mind, caste as it existed before Britishers and from whenever was abhorrent as an idea because it suppressed democratic rights and equity in society. It was not, and all history proves, it was not the British that came in and turned it vast. The caste system for decades and hundreds of years before that was debilitating for Indian society. But regardless,
I have never disputed that viewpoint. It is completely untrue. I mean, that I disagreed with, that is untrue. All we were doing was to provide justification in a limited fashion for, I mean, to understand why caste system persisted only in India. This is a puzzle. And as intellectuals, we were trying to find whether there were any clues to answers to that puzzle. That's all we said. It had nothing to do with justification. I mean, let me tell you my personal history. I must say this. My father refused to perform thread ceremony for his sons, including me. He stated publicly in 1940s that the distinction, caste-based distinction, have become so abhorrent that we must completely throw them away. That was the system I was brought up in. That was the family I was brought up in. I never had in mind any issue of justification of caste system. But I am an honest intellectual. If something was puzzling me, then of course I seek answers to that. That's all.
Thank you so much. I think we have 4.5 minutes, so 3 questions. And if you could kindly just keep to the question and not a statement. Unfortunately, I've spoken too much. The gentleman at the front, and could other people just raise their hand? Can I go at the gentleman at the last and then the gentleman in the middle? Sorry, I'm... Gonna do this quickly.
That was a, you know, very obvious clash of ideas, this discussion, and it was quite obvious that both of you had a stark difference of opinion
I completely agree with him. This is just a theatrical performance I was doing.
So my question is, maybe a dialogue should always end in a solution, where as an audience we deserve a solution, and you know, very concisely, you know, maybe as a bullet point, Nithin, both of you, if you could tell us, like, what is the solution that you see? It could be it may be your personal solution to this crisis. We are grappling with population, we are undernourished, we have poverty, we have people who don't have land and everything, and then we have to protect.
Sure.
So very concisely, bullet point, your personal
Certainly.
And yours.
Can I take all the questions and maybe we can respond at one time, sir? Will that be fine? Sorry, the gentleman at the back. I'm going to just go by sequence of which hand.
Statement that there should be an accountability for the things. Whether my question is simple, whether the elected representatives are really accountable in the present condition.
That's a simple question. No, they are not. gentleman in the middle in spectacles with a grey beard. Thank you.
Nithin Gogale, you seem to have taken the brief from the opponents of the Gadgil report, the way you have questioned, to seeking to undermine the thing. And do you have any comments on that?
Certainly. Madhav, would you like to respond to the first one when the gentleman asked, what are the quick...
I am very happy that it has led to many desirable... developments, including many very good pieces of legislation. the 73rd and 74th Amendment, which attempts to devolute powers to lower levels. Then the recent Forest Rights Act and so on, which actually authorize in certain limited context, no doubt, the Gram Sabhas to make all decisions, and then a whole range of Environment Protection Acts, Water Act, Air Act, and so on. They are all a consequence of democracy. So I am, by every means, stressing that we must now allow this democratic process to decide on kind of growth we need and the direction in which it should go. I don't think the democratic processes, if allowed to play their full role, would ever decide on a system which is continually worsening disparities in the society and permitting the rich and powerful to, with greater and greater impunity, crush popular opposition to many things. So we must make sure that there is proper, honest, democratic devolution. Secondly, we certainly would not want a system where the laws exist, but they are not implemented at all. And we must make sure that the Environment Protection Act laws are properly implemented. If we ensure these two things, then we will move towards more desirable pattern of growth. And our report, I have never actually said that we must immediately halt all growth. More than that, I have never said that we must immediately halt all growth so that the current levels of poverty are frozen. I have never said that, and that would not be the consequence of following our democratically passed legislation of especially relating to democratic devolution and environmental protection. So first and foremost, we must simply, honestly implement this legislation. And we should not be talking about all these high-flown ideas of growth and how Indira Gandhiji also in 1971, I guess, whatever, the Stockholm talked about poverty is the greatest polluter and garibi hatao. Or kya hua hai itne saal? So all this kind of talk is not what we want. We want actually a law-abiding democratic society. And let that society shape the kind of growth it wants.
Thanks. Again, it's just the right note to end on. I completely agree with him. A deepening of democracy is essential for us to survive ecologically as well. Anything and anything in my mind that attempts to short-circuit a bad democracy by setting up a counter panel of few people deciding is a route in the wrong direction. You need a better elected representative. You need a democracy that functions beyond elections. You need elections which are not funded by certain powerful forces that create a certain kind of elected representative and then don't answer to us, but answer to people who fund those elections. To answer the gentleman in the middle who asked whether I come from a lobby which hits the kind of ideas he has, again, this sounds very stupid, but I'm a journalist who's lost job thrice in the last 3 years for writing in favor of people like him. My job here was to present questions that challenge him and answer you in a way that maybe a friend would not get him to talk. Do I disagree with a little bit of him? Yes, but then that's democracy. Do I dislike his idea on caste? Obviously I do. I come from an area that's never seen caste, but do I think he's a doyen of ecology? Absolutely, undoubtedly. We've not had a legend bigger than him. Will there be others who'll step on his shoulders and do better? Yes, they will.
But I don't like caste. I mean, this is a nonsensical statement.
We agree to disagree on that one. Thank you so much for your patience. Sorry if I sounded very crude in asking my questions, but that was my job. I promise you, otherwise I'm a polite person. Not as polite as him, but somewhere getting around there.
Now, gift giving ceremony.
I invite program committee.